Kano are seeking for technical assistance from Nigeria to replicate the Nigeria's model in their countries. To further place the Federal Road Safety Corps in a position where it could render such support to other African countries, the federal government of Nigeria has continued to support the Corps' operation through increased budgetary allocations and enforcement of capability of its personnel. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, on this note, I admit me to Your Excellency to welcome you all to this special occasion and also to call on all Nigerians to continue to support and rally around the Federal Road Safety Corps as it contributes to make our roads safer. I thank you, Your Excellencies, for your kind attention.
Thank you. because every time, vote on me, vote on me, vote on me.
Which one I be? How I didn't know all these things about?
My friend, it's quite simple. See,
improve post-crash response.
Oga English, this is your English is just a speaker. In 2 months, we went to consign an ordinary woman like me, United Nations, 2010, pro safety, action.
In other words, good and safe road users save lives. Then, good and safe road users will save money. I mean, save, just think about it.
Yeah, we are true. Okay, barista. Now, if you say, if the road is good and safe, ordinary drivers like us, we can go more trips, and then we can make more money. And then you say, the job can be carried gold.
No, okay, you don't talk well. As long as my wife be like this, I go steal my market, shout. I go whip this house. So I go get that for my husband and my children.
Very correct.
So you mean with this, the 1.9 million people projected to die before 2020 can be drastically
exactly. I got it.
Mr. Driver,
promise me you'll get your right document.
Yes, sir.
You'll fix your tires. In fact, just go repair your bus.
Yes, sir. Okay? Yes, sir. Yes,
and passengers, please be cautious of the board. The bus you board, okay? It must be roadworthy. You get my point?
Yes,
good. You can go.
But what if I go be the way forward now?
You see, on the way forward, the Federal Road Safety Board, they've come up with numerous interventions plan, like increase public perception, yes, and also effective traffic management. Beautiful, right? And swift post-crash services.
Okay. Oh, no. Come on, stop that, you don't take pictures.
And finally, they've collaborated with relevant agencies to ensure that road safety is not just a commission, but an experience we get on Nigerian roads. Ladies and gentlemen, you see, the safety of our road is in your hands and in our hands. Very important.
Together we stand to make our road safe. For you and for me, together we can. So come join us now to make our road safe. It's for you and for me, together we can.
Together we stand to make our road safe. For you and for me, together we can. So come join us now to make our road safe.
Chairman of the occasion.
ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here with you today in Abuja on behalf of the United Nations Secretary General as his special envoy for road safety, and to participate in the 7th annual lecture series organized by the Federal Road Safety Corps. I would like first to congratulate you all on your country's commitment to advancing road safety in line with the United Nations Decade of Action for Road Safety and the Sustainable Development Goals. I urge the Nigeria government to continue its efforts to curb the economic and social cost of road crashes. When I meet with leaders around the world and in Africa, including the President of Kenya, President of Rwanda, President of Ethiopia, and most recently, the President of Mauritius, I see a real willingness to take action, which is already a major step in itself. Ladies and gentlemen, I have two convictions. First, Africa is a priority for road safety, and secondly, the solutions must be implemented on a continent scale. In that regard, I am pleased that the Nigeria government is taking significant steps toward curbing the rising trend of road traffic fatalities. I applaud your determination to halve the number of road traffic fatalities by 2020, as outlined in the National Road Safety Strategy, and for the vision of placing Nigeria amongst the world's 20 safest countries in road safety by 2020. These are ambitious goals, but I'm confident that with the lead road safety agency, the Federal Road Safety Corps, and the strong commitments of all stakeholders, Nigeria has great potential to achieve the highest levels of road safety. According to the African 2015 Road Safety Midterm Review, Nigeria is one of the top 5 countries in terms of road safety performance in Africa. And there is scope for sharing their practice with other African countries. Today, we are heavily dependent on road transport. Whether it is for the movement of people or goods, in fact, it is estimated that 90% of people and freight in Nigeria rely on the road network for transportation. Such heavy dependence on road transport means that we must ensure that this movement is safe. Africa suffers from the highest rate of road traffic fatalities in the world, despite having some of the lowest numbers of registered vehicles. When you see how traffic is sometimes managed by countries and the number of people who put their lives in danger every day by not wearing their seatbelts or not wearing helmets on motorcycles, you realize the scale of the challenge we face. We must and can do much more to make roads safe. Fortunately, we know the solutions. We need safer roads and infrastructure, safer vehicles, safer user behavior, better legislation, stronger enforcement, improved post-crash care, as well as better means to evaluate and monitor progress through availability of quality data. For example, national statistics report 6,000 and the WHO estimates more than 35,000 road traffic fatalities deaths in Nigeria every year. We need to do much more to secure reliable data and reach agreement on recorded figures. The solutions I have outlined are reflected in the United Nations Decade of Action for Road Safety pillars and the African Road Safety Action Plan. Most importantly, They are also reflected in Nigeria's national road safety strategy. Nigeria could set an example for the region through the implementation of its national strategy, such as with the recent establishment of a national road traffic crash data management system. This will help address the need for better coordinated data collection and management, which is a critical issue across the continent. A big opportunity also exists with increased accession to the UN Road Safety Conventions, particularly those on road traffic, on road signs and signals, on vehicle safety, and on transport of dangerous goods by road. These legal instruments are the basis for enforcing laws that address top risk factors such as drink driving, seatbelt and helmet use, child restraints, and speed, which on their own can significantly decrease the number of road traffic fatalities. I wish to highlight that Nigeria is a contracting party to one of the United Nations Road Safety Conventions, and I would like to encourage accession to all the six. Achieving the global, regional, and national strategies does not come without cost. It is indispensable that resources devoted to road safety on all levels are far too low. It has been estimated that HIV/AIDS attracted 1,000 times more funds than road safety between 2012 and 2014. And the comparison with other global scourges like malaria and tuberculosis is in the similar order of magnitude. In order to address this shortfall and to facilitate better contribution to this cause, work has been underway to establish a new UN Road Safety Fund. If followed through, the fund will be an important resource for everyone working on road safety. This work was following a recommendation from a United Nations resolution from improving global road safety adopted last April in New York. A paper outlining the proposed structure of the fund has been put together by the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe in collaboration with other UN regional commissions such as UNECA and WHO. The proposal provides for the first time a clear indication of the amount of funding required to attain our SDGs targets. The potential uses of the funding, key partners, and the governance framework. This will be a huge significance in the fight to turn the tide of rising fatality numbers, but only if the catalytic funding is complemented by national investments made by governments towards road safety. The report also emphasizes that within these pillars, there is a strong need to support national and local governments and authorities to ensure the effective development and implementation of national road safety plans, strategies, and legislation. We hope that Nigeria will support the proposal for UN Road Safety Fund. Increased resources, political will, and strong regulatory framework will contribute to the achievement of our global goals. The 2030 agenda has incorporated the growing concern for road safety into targets of sustainable development goals. Target 3.6 aims to halve the number of global deaths and injuries from road traffic crashes by 2020. Target 11.2 aims to provide access to safe, affordable, accessible, and sustainable transport systems for all by 2030. If we are to make progress in meeting these targets, there must be strong cooperation across ministries, governmental agencies, and operating coalitions that bring together relevant stakeholders. I'm pleased to see such a good representation from different sectors here today and encourage you all to include road safety as a core priority in your activities. There is an urgent need to scale up our efforts. The Sustainable Development Goal targets cannot be achieved without substantial progress in Africa. While fatalities from other major causes are projected to decline in the region, road fatalities are expected to increase exponentially. If no changes are made, and we must make work to change this projection. Also, we have tremendous work ahead of us. As I have outlined, there is also significant attention and support for our cause on the global stage, and much of it for the very first time. We have a strong foundation in place with a global plan for the Decade of Action for Road Safety and the Africa Road Safety Action Plan. Together, with a setting of ambitious national targets, strong political will and governance, as well as cross-sectoral support, Nigeria is very well placed to make significant achievement in road safety. I thank you all for being here and investing for road safety, and I look forward for a further discussion. Thank you. Now I would like to introduce our panelists, some of whom we have collaborated with before. Senator Udo Udoma, the Minister of Budget and National Planning. Mrs. Tawa Ado-Strong, Senior Transport Specialist at the World Bank. And Tawa's role and guidance was instrumental in conducting our joint regional workshop in Kenya. Dr. Obel Odumakin, President, Women Arise for Change Initiative from Lagos. And Dr. Antoinette Wicks, Director of Infrastructure, ECOWAS Commission from Abuja. And I would like Senator Udoma to take it over. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tobbs. Here this morning. First, I'd like to acknowledge that the Minister of Budget and National Planning, Senator Udoma, is unavoidably absent at this event. However, the discussions will still go ahead, and I'll introduce to you to the stand-in discussant for this lecture, and that's in addition to the others that we already introduced. Just quickly for me to say that Engineer N.E. Lowell, who is Director of Infrastructure in the Ministry of Budget and National Planning. He will be joining in this discussion, and I do believe that I've placed a seat somewhere there by my right. And since he'll be part of this discussion, he's going to come right over here. And I do hope that the technical crew will have him wired up, as we say. Very much, Engineer Eni Lawal. He's Director of Infrastructure in the Ministry of Budget and National Planning. He'll be part of this discussion. Of course, the other discussants introduced, Mrs. Tawa Ado-Strong, Senior Transport Specialist in the World Bank Country Office in Kenya. Dr. Joe K. who's President, Women Arise for Change Initiative in Lagos. And Engineer Ashoke Maliki, who is a road infrastructure and safety expert. He comes from ECOWAS. And of course, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we do have Professor Wole Soyinka. Yes, Prof. Well, we have not listed Prof as one of the discussants. We do know that his comments on the theme of this lecture would be invaluable as we put together how to achieve the goals of the UN Decade of Action for Road Safety in Africa. Just a quick mention that there have been collaborators and supporters of this effort in winning the Delta State Government with the Special Advisor on Intergovernmental Affairs, Honorable Pascal Kadigwe, representing the Government of Delta State. So, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, as we kickstart the discussions here, we would, at this point, just before the other discussants come in, Professor Walesho Inka, we would love you to make a few comments about the theme of this lecture. Just before this was in the second.
The military. disrespect anyone who disrespected the road, who disrespected the lives and rights of other people. That principle, I hope, is being retained. Till today, the issue of ego on the road is principally central to the carnage which we witness. And it's particularly lamentable in this nation where everybody feels that they are number one under any circumstances. Therefore, on the road, they feel they must behave like number one. Just taking down the ego of the Nigerian citizen, that is the you and me, remains the primary problem of road safety codes. Having said that, let me remind you, I'm a human rights advocate, and that is why I'm taking the trouble to join you today. My principal concern is humanity. And when you talk of fundamental human rights, I want us always to remember that the first protocol, written or unwritten, of fundamental human rights is the right to life. That is absolutely non-negotiable. So if you're serious about building a nation, you have to be serious about getting citizens to respect that fundamental law, the right to life of every principle. If you need a new motto, you can put that on your uniforms, but it's better even inside your heads. That applies both to the uniformed corps and to the citizens, the special marshals who form the backbone, the citizen special marshals, from the backbone of road safety. In those chapters, there is a chapters among the justices of the peace, chapters in schools, chapters in universities. You have chapters in the media, and this is what I understand as citizen participation. All, each and every one of those chapters, all the members, always emblazon that protocol in your mind. That first law of human rights is the right to life of all citizens, all humanity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Lighting us with those comments. I'm sure you agree with me that we needed that. The discussants here, we have Engineer N.E. Lowell, Director of Infrastructure, Ministry of Budget and National Planning, who will kickstart the discussion briefly.
Heavily skewed towards the road transportation in the country, about 90%. the paper presented by our guest speaker. But the government is also doing something to reflect this, but also giving other modes due attention. Besides that, the issue of road safety is what is one that is mainstream in the three objectives of the midterm plan of the government, the economic recovery and growth plan. It has three objectives: economic recovery, it has ensuring globally competitive economy, as well as investing in our people. The issue of road safety cuts across those three objectives. Because if we continue to lose your people, manpower, through road traffic crashes, there is enormous loss to the economy. And there is no way, if your economy is losing its core people at their prime, that it can be competitive. And the issue of investing in the people is also paramount to ensure road safety, because we have to give people the right culture on the road, as well as ensuring that they imbibe the right culture, and as well as what that they need to do. Now, let me say that the National Transport Policy about to be finalized, the issue of road safety is one that is also being steeped in the National Transport Policy, as well as the National Urban Transport Policy. So this issue of road safety is one that is paramount to the government. Let me also say that the Ministry of Budget and National Planning, through the MIE system, is tracking progress towards achieving the set goals in the National Road Safety Strategy. Let me raise here, please.
All right, thank you very much, But taking it from there, the view of Daniel, let's come to Gil Maki. Achieving the goals, would it be legislation, education, advocacy, etc.?
The representative of the Vice President of the Republic of Nigeria, our guest speaker, UN Special Envoy for Road Safety, ministers, the chairman of our board, and our colleague, Paul Mashak, I received the call. Panelists on the service level, distinguished ladies and gentlemen of the press, I'm glad to be part of this epoch-making event. I firmly believe that we live where we exist for others. And like we have heard here today, road safety is everyone's responsibility. From the elusive presentation of our guest speaker, he made reference to the fact that our country, Nigeria, top five in terms of road safety. And then the colossal loss of lives that has been recorded as a result of fatality, about 6,000 lives. Also juxtaposing with the youths who we lose daily between the age of 15 and 29. Sad enough, to take action, we'll be losing 19 million annually by 2020. The way forward, reducing drinking and driving through random breath testing. This law has been tried in Australia, and it reduced fatality rate drastically from 45% to 20%. In our country, Nigeria, it is possible for such laws to be instituted. And that's why I'm glad that members of the National Assembly are present here with us. Because if such law is passed, the Federal Road Safety Corps can enforce such laws in conjunction with the National Union of Road Transport Workers. We're going to have someone within the motor park who serves as a coordinator, who inspects and takes breath tests of any driver that wants to move out. And then to ensure compliance, the Federal Road Safety Officers can also stop and perform breath tests on the driver randomly. We know how some of our officers and men have been attacked viciously when they want to enforce laws. So without having such laws, it's going to be difficult for anyone to be stopped and you want to take random breath tests. The test, if you want to perform such, you know that that person will be viciously attacked. So I want to plead, and I also want to support that such laws should be instituted, so that at the end, we are going to have media campaigns, and such can be enforced, and then we are going to have public acceptance of such. Yes, we want to thank the federal government, like what the UN envoy has said, in trying to implement this and achieve the goals of the UN Decade of Action for Road Safety. But we also want to plead that there should be establishment of a nationwide ambulance service, nationwide, if such is done, and we have dedicated hotlines, we see that it's going to reduce the level of fatality. It's been done in Ghana. In 2000, people that had accidents were taken to various hospitals. In 2004, when it now gathered political will from the Ghanaian government, it reduced drastically the rate of fatality and response. So I believe that Nigeria, as a leading giant of Africa, if we have nationwide ambulance established, I firmly believe that we are going to reduce the rate of fatalities. Finally, I want to say that as civil society activists and practitioners, we should organize less and organize more. In organizing more, we should ensure that we create heavy awareness. And in creating heavy awareness, we see that a lot of needless life that is being lost on our roads will be drastically reduced. Life is sacrosanct. It remains the most important thing. No one has the right to take such life. So as a result of that, all of us must become stakeholders and ambassadors. And like the chairman of today's occasion has said, we need to do a lot in ensuring that life is preserved. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And drawing attention to alcohol and drugs in road safety. Of course, rounding off with what Professor Shoika has spoken about, self-policing and citizens' participation. But we have here Mrs. Tawe Ado Asho, City of Transport Specialist, World Bank Country Visit Kenya, and we see from the grim statistics that Africa records the highest number of fatalities from road crashes. So give us the perspective.
Thank you very much. We have only 2% of the world's vehicles, but we're responsible for about 20% of the world's fatalities. Africa as a continent is growing economically and socially, and therefore we realize that as part of the economic growth, there will be more vehicles as people get wealthier. If this situation remains where even with a little percentage of vehicles we have now, we are responsible for 20% of the fatalities, it's going to be a huge challenge across the continent. Nigeria is one of, if not the biggest, populated country in the continent, and we really commend the way that the Federal Road Safety Corps is at advancing the issue around road safety. A key area, again, for Africa is that more than half the deaths are the most vulnerable people in our society. These are the pedestrians, the people who are walking, the people who are using motorcycles, the people are using bicycles, and this must change. In our countries, the more people are walking than in vehicles, then when we set road safety policies and strategies in place, we must make sure we incorporate how we are going to make sure we take care of these most vulnerable people on the roads. So we do things like decreasing speeds within cities where the people are more likely to be walking, or they're more likely to be two or three wheelers. We change the road infrastructure to separate, ensure that there are pavements for the pedestrians. There's maybe a separated lane for the cyclists, the motorcycles. And these all bring down the opportunities of conflicts between the different types of vehicles. And then with the lower speeds, if there is a crash, there's less likely to be a fatality. And this is one of the targets that the FRSC has. The other issue is to have the good laws in place, as the doctor was saying. And again, I commend the partnership between the FRSC, the House of Representatives here, and the Senate, where there's a very good relationship in dialoguing on the issues around road safety and the importance of having the laws improved. And therefore, they have the partnership in Parliament and the House of Representatives to make sure that this agenda is moved forward. Because without good legislation, we cannot have good enforcement, because the enforcement is a result of the legislation which is in place. So if the law is not good, the people who are required to enforce cannot do their job properly. And then if you go a step further, is that when the legislation is in place, as I mentioned, how do we enforce it? And again, an organization like the Corps, that's their core value, they are to enforce the laws which are in place. If the laws are enforced well, as we see often in the West, human beings tend to, they're no good human beings, really. It's the laws and society which keeps us in check. So if the laws are enforced, if someone is stopped for speeding, if someone is stopped and fined for drink driving, I'll give an example. I was in the US and I was sped in an area where it was supposed to be 25 miles per hour. I wasn't paying attention, I was going closer to 40. The policeman was very nice, stopped me, but struck me with a bill of $250. If I didn't pay within a month, it doubled. If I didn't pay within 6 months, I go to jail. You pay immediately, and the next time, you won't speed. So the value of having enforcement and keeping it in place makes sure that the citizens and the society starts to really take recognizance of what is going on. Then, with all this in place, how do you measure and see that you are actually doing what? You are getting results. And this is when I commend again the FRSC with the establishment of a database, because now they can actually check and see whether the laws are working, whether the enforcement is working, how many people are dying, how many people are injured, how many vehicles are being inspected, how many driver's licenses are being produced. All these are sort of intermediate measures that you need to look at to see whether the sum total of what you're doing is working. And then measuring the number of people wearing seat belts, the number of people wearing helmets. Once you see these increasing, you know the fact of that people are getting safer. There's a safer environment in the country. The other area that I'll touch on briefly is on vehicle safety. And our honorable guest speaker mentioned the fact that Nigeria is party to some of these conventions, and it is important that in an environment where the average age of
infrastructure, that's where we bring in engineer Ashoki Maliki.
expert in road infrastructure. The Equest Commission has come up with a lot of protocol relating to issues related to road infrastructure. Most especially is the supplementary act on accident control. This is very crucial because one, it controls overload, it defines the limit, the accident for different vehicles with different configuration. They also look at the safety of the vehicle itself. So in terms of infrastructure, yes, it's very important. This is the second pillar. And having said that, I also want to add that the Equest Commission have been working closely with the Federal Road Safety Board of Nigeria through the West African Road Safety Organization. We rely heavily on the experiences of the Federal Road Safety Commission in spreading the issue of road safety across the West African region. We've come up with a lot of project initiative, especially the retroflective banner on vehicles. We also harmonized the data collection templates among the West African sub-region. And midway into the taking of action, the Equest Commission did carry out an assessment on the level of implementation of the 15 Equest member states. And I can tell you that Nigeria came up tops. Nigeria did follow the African Action Plan agreed in 2011. And from the experiences of Nigeria, we were able to, through WASO, train assist other member states who are lacking behind. So in terms of that, we would like to see further advocacy because one of the leading causes of road crashes in West Africa is attributed to the human factor. So we want to see more of the advocacy the road users. This is very crucial for us and important if we have to save lives. And secondly, we, based on our assessment, we also discovered that within the West African region, the model, the Nigerian model, the lead model, the lead model is very important because we can see the successes from the lead agency from Nigeria, which has a political backing as well as legislation backing it, and then adequate. So within the West African region, we are looking at replicating this, and we intend to do that through the West Parliament, legislators there, who can also talk to their colleagues in their various countries. And more importantly, I want to conclude that it is important that in carrying out route design, it is important that the route audit